Welcome to Escape to the Country. Now, in the late 18th century, a young local poet composed a sonnet dedicated to the river behind me before he went on to become one of the founding members of a famous literary movement. But who was he, and where did he come to find such inspiration? Well, join me in just a moment, and I'll tell you. Today, a nature-loving couple try to balance the equation of home and land. The house itself sits in the middle of 80 acres.
80.
Elements of a life outdoors certainly appeal.
Come on.
Isn't that just the most gorgeous thing?
Boy, have we set the scene for you here.
You have indeed.
And the properties seem to measure up.
Oh, wow.
That's good.
That's Christmas lunch sorted out, isn't it?
Isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, today we are in Devon, and this is the very beautiful River Otter that so inspired the poet Samuel Taylor Coleridge to write his sonnet to the River Otter. Now, he was born in 1772, the son of a local vicar. He and William Wordsworth went on to become very good friends, and together played an important role in what, in literary circles, is now regarded as the Romantic movement. Well, today, the River Otter has a slightly different tale to tell. It's become home to the first population of wild beavers in England. Now, later on in the programme, I'll be back here finding out how they are getting on. But in the meantime, well, here's a taste of what the rest of this gorgeous county has to offer. Devon's two coastlines look out toward the Atlantic to the north and the English Channel to the south. A largely rural and sparsely populated county, at its heart sits one of its two national parks, Dartmoor. This vast moorland covers some 386 square miles and is made up of undulating uplands, granite tors, and deep valleys. Heading to the south coast is the historic fishing town of Brixham. It was here that William of Orange landed when embarking on the Glorious Revolution in 1688. With history still preserved in so many of its buildings and terrain charted by kings and poets alike, it's no surprise that Devon is a popular choice for those escaping the city in search of a traditional country life. Now, buying in Devon can be a fairly costly affair. Currently, the average price of a detached home here is £355,000. That's some £30,000 above the national figure. Now, those numbers are in part boosted by the popularity of coastal hotspots such as Topsham and Salcombe. But the good news is that if you do want a bit more value for money, heading inland to the beautiful landscape you can see behind me is never going to let you down. And that's also good news for today's buyers who want exactly this sort of thing. But not only do they need a home, they also want land, and lots of it. Karen and John have been together for the past 20 years, and for the majority of that time, have been living a life centred on the practicalities of work in the town of Maidenhead, Berkshire.
Our current house at the moment really has a bit of house of convenience.
The fact that I can get up to London every day, etc. When I no longer have to do that, then I no longer have to live here.
John works in sales and Karen is a legal assistant. With their own house sold, they're currently packing up to move into rented accommodation, so their country move is quickly gaining momentum. And although they intend to retire, they've got other goals to achieve before that.
Plan now is very much towards working towards retirement.
Not being on deadlines and what time is it? I've got to get this done by that time.
Probably a little bit early to sit and go to the bingo and do nothing. The idea is to have a very much change of lifestyle.
Karen and John see that springboard to a better quality of life coming from a complete change of location, so they've set their sights on Devon.
We both spent a lot of family holidays down there.
I quite like to be near to the sea, and the fact that if I could jump in the car and 30 minutes away go and walk along the beach, that would be good.
I've always said I certainly don't want to be on the coast. I don't like looking out on the sea particularly. I'd rather look out over fields.
They both enjoy being outdoors, and Karen has plans to grow one of her favourite pastimes.
My love of gardening really started quite a number of years ago. I go outside to do something quickly and then find that I'm still out there 3 hours later. I'd quite like to have a polytunnel when we get to the new property so that I can extend the growing season.
John, meanwhile, wants to reconnect with nature.
My interest in wildlife and nature as a whole has really dominated my life. I'm open to any opportunity or any ideas to doing something that's a little bit more proactive with regard to conservation. Certainly appeals.
As well as supporting the fauna and flora in their new surroundings, they also have ambitious plans to keep their own animals.
I'd certainly like some pasture land to be able to keep some type of livestock, whether that be sheep or cattle. I think I'd be more of a hobby farmer, but I don't think that's to be taken too lightly. If you're looking after livestock, you've got to know what you're doing.
Something new to learn about, isn't it?
Although it's a radical leap of lifestyle, they're both excited at the prospect of immersing themselves in a full-on countryside experience and seem to be anticipating the challenges.
I would like to think it's going to be less stressful. I think the reality is that if you are a stressed person, you might be a stressed person. So I might just be stressed about whether or not the sheep are lambing or what have you. But I'd like to think it's going to be a more comfortable stress, I think is maybe a better way to describe it. That's kind of really what I'm looking forward to.
Although John and Karen have their sights set on Devon, they're also open to considering the neighbouring counties. So I'm meeting up with them to talk through the priorities for their move.
Well, guys, I think this seems like an appropriate place to start our conversation this week. John, Karen, welcome to Devon on what looks like a beautiful week. Look at the weather.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
Not done badly, have we?
Now, this is a really interesting move, I think, because you're going from something very modest in Maidenhead to something potentially very immodest in the southwest. Karen, what exactly are you looking for?
The house for me, I think one of the key points is a large kitchen.
Yeah.
Utility room. Bedrooms, not so fussed about, you know, minimum three.
So actually fairly sort of flexible, except for the big kitchen.
Yeah.
I'd be amazed if you found anywhere for us that had too large a kitchen. So I think part of the process of moving to the country is, for me, getting involved with wildlife, maybe livestock as well.
So let's talk about the amount of land upon which this might unfold then.
Really looking ideally from around the 28 acre mark upwards.
Have you ever seen what 20 acres looks like?
Not really.
Look around you now. This beautiful garden here is probably about an acre. Don't forget, land is the most expensive thing on the market at the moment. You know, what we buy in acres, we lose in property.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It's worth thinking about that balance. So let's talk about the other numbers that are pertinent to this house search. Let's talk about the budget.
Right. I think the bottom end is going to be £750,000 up to £1.25 million. Quite a range.
Quite a range. I mean, what an amazing budget to find you something with lots of land, minimum three bedrooms and a big kitchen. Sounds pretty doable, doesn't it, really?
Yeah, it should be easy.
It should be easy. It should be easy. I'm not worried about the budget. I am worried about what we're going to buy with it and what you're going to do with it, but hopefully the properties will give us some ideas as to what your future might look like. Should we go?
Yep. Yes,
come
looking forward
to it. Let's go spend some money. Come on, follow me.
Willing to take their budget as high as £1.25 million, Karen and John are looking for their fair share of Devon's green and plentiful land. They'd like a minimum of 20 acres to fulfil John's dream of establishing a small holding. What's more, the property needs to deliver a minimum of three bedrooms and the large kitchen Karen requested. We've lined up a fine selection of properties, all serving up different options. They won't know the cost of each one, though, until I reveal it at the end of the tour. Lastly, of course, we'll see our mystery house, which will challenge them on exactly which is more important, acres or architecture. We're kick-starting our house hunt in rural Devon by heading to the remote outskirts of the village of Witheridge. Residents can make use of a pub, village store, and a choice of places to eat and drink. And less than a 5-minute drive away is property number one.
Right, there we are. We thought we'd start with something quite kind of traditional house-wise.
got plenty of character.
And one thing that interests me about your story is that we don't really know what we're going to do with all this land that you are keen to buy. The house itself sits in the middle of 80 acres.
80.
Okay. This is going to be a really good test as to what you do.
The 80 acres, you kind of had me straight away. I thought, yeah. I ought to go and explore it. Yeah.
We will give you plenty of time to explore it. Come on.
There will be plenty of time later for John to get a handle on those 80 acres. This former farmhouse was near derelict when the current owners purchased it in 2001. Due to its Grade 2 listed status, they were required to rebuild it using traditional methods. The result is this wonderfully charming cob and stone-built home with a thatched roof.
Oh, isn't it nice? Got the inglenook there, of course, the fire.
Like the fireplace.
I mean, they've got it as a sort of dining hall, I suppose. There is a really nice reception room next door, and it's separated by this gorgeous panelling behind me. Come and have a look at this. There. See, I think this is perhaps a little cosier.
Definitely. Yes. Yeah, another fire. Mm-hmm. Definitely got a more warm, cosy feeling.
Probably the most important part of the house for Karen is still to be seen. Could well swing either way.
OK, let's go and deal with the kitchen, though. Come on, it's just through here.
It's obvious John is completely focused on getting outside as quickly as possible, but he'll have to be patient for just a bit longer as we head back through the dining room to show Karen the kitchen.
As you can see, kitchen diner, the diner at that end. I think I know what you're going to say.
Not big enough.
Not big enough. As a kitchen diner within a cottage, it's fine.
Yeah.
But yeah, I do take your point. It's not acres of kitchen. The reason being is because we've got lots of acres outside. That's where that balance comes.
It's not a bad size kitchen, actually. It's a trade-off.
For you, land is a real driver. I think for you, the house is the driver,
yeah,
isn't it? For the life that I am picturing, that you have described, you don't need 80 acres. Mm. You'd happily do it on 10. You really would.
I don't know if I can afford the tractors.
Oh, yes, you could. Come on.
Well, so far, Karen has had some mixed reactions to the downstairs living spaces. But upstairs, this home provides four bedrooms. There's a cosy double, as well as two further single rooms. The master's period features and high ceiling give it a light and airy feel, and it has its own ensuite shower room. Next, we're heading outside to take in the land that's on offer. This property comes with a huge range of outbuildings, the main one having once been a farm shop and butcher's. There's also an existing polytunnel which Karen was keen to have. One of the unique selling points of this estate is its wild meadow. It's known as Culm grassland and is considered endangered and is the perfect space for a budding conservationist if the acreage doesn't prove too daunting.
Okay, your 80-acre estate. This field is part of it, but it's a nice, I suppose, indicator of what you get. Lots of wildflowers. You've got this field, there's one similarly sized beyond that hedge line down to the bottom, and beyond that again, and beyond again. I think you get the idea. Go on then, Karen. What do you think this one is on the market for?
I think this one's going to be difficult because of the 80 acres.
Yep.
I'm going for £900,000.
£900,000? John's weighing that up.
80 acres doesn't come cheap, I think. So I'm probably going to go a little higher than that, around 975, I think.
975. Your instincts are absolutely right. This is on the market for £1 million.
You're not really getting a £1 million house. You're getting a house that has a certain value and you're getting a parcel of land that has its own very separate value almost.
That's exactly right. And I think, to be fair, you don't need 80 acres.
I do want this wildflower meadow, though.
Maybe there's a separate deal to be had just for this. Look, I'm going to let you go and have a wander around the house and just make sense of that trade-off between land and property.
Yeah.
Off you go.
Thank you.
I might go for a wander myself, although I'm not sure I should walk around all of it. 80 acres, it's quite big.
On the market for a straight £1 million, this Grade 2 listed thatched farmhouse comes with two reception rooms, a cosy kitchen and four bedrooms. Outside, there's an eye-watering 80 acres on offer, which includes some beautiful and rare wild meadow. What's more, there's income potential from its many outbuildings.
John's obviously more with the land than the house, I think, but what we'd realistically do with 80 acres is something that we'd have to seriously consider.
I think Jules is of the opinion that he can scare me with the acreage, but the reality is I don't have a problem with the size of it. In fact, I love it. Give me more.
I have to say I was disappointed with the kitchen. It was not the size that I'd hoped for.
I think it could be a challenge to compromise on here. The house, as nice as it is, it probably wouldn't suit us. If we can find the house that warms our souls as soon as we walk through the door, then clearly I'm going to be compromising on that.
Oh, where has the sun gone? What have you done to the weather?
Yeah, four seasons in a day.
Yeah, well, welcome to Devon. It's like Wales. Good, OK, so that's the first one done. £1 million, eh? You going to buy it?
Not convinced.
Not convinced?
No.
The upside to that, of course, is that we've still got your budget to spend.
Come indeed.
Over 70% of Devon's landscape is given over to farming and has shaped the region over the centuries. Our couple want to buy into a slice of that agricultural heritage, and it's the driving factor behind their move. But as they're both self-confessed novices, they're extremely keen to receive some help and guidance on how to support and care for their land whilst working in harmony with the existing wildlife. We've sent them to meet Carol Williams, who's mastered the art of husbandry, a farming practice dating back to the Middle Ages, underpinned by principles that enable land to be worked and managed sustainably. To understand more about this holistic approach, John and Karen are meeting Carol on her farm in Bickington, South Devon, from where she teaches her courses.
Hi, Carol. John.
John, welcome to the husbandry school.
Thank you very much.
Fantastic view you've got here.
Yeah, it's a pretty impressive piece of Devon. We started off with 10 acres, and now we look after 49.
Must keep you pretty busy.
Yeah, it's a lot of work, and in fact, we've got some very hungry goats that need feeding. Look, I've got a job for you. Oh,
Although there's evidence of husbandry practiced throughout the UK, Devon is recognised as a pioneer. It's even thought that Oliver Cromwell acknowledged the success of this county's sustainable farming methods. Carol has some basic tips for John and Karen so they can make their future farm or small holding productive and as sustainable as possible.
This is a husbandry school, so we run it on husbandry lines.
And what kind of topics does husbandry cover?
Husbandry means to take care of the boundaries of what you're responsible for and everything within it. We need to make sure that everything is working together.
We're interested in encouraging wildlife and possibly keeping some livestock as well. Is there any advice you can give us with regard to that?
Well, that's the perfect balance together. That is what husbandry is. It means everything has more than one job. Every animal has a job. Every piece of the land has a job. And you think of doing one job, think about it, and make sure that you're doing three jobs in that one job. Let's go.
It may appear a picture-perfect scene of country living, but Carol's farm is very much a carefully considered and organised working farm, where all the components are brought together to utilise the land to maximum effect. As around 75% of Britain's land is farmed, it's increasingly important that less intensive methods of working and managing the landscape are adopted.
We grow everything companion planted. Plants, they're grown side by side to look after each other. They might then put nutrients back in the soil that their neighbour might need. So we're using the plants as part of the whole. The runner ducks, they're here for slug patrol. So we'll fence off an area of the garden, put the runner ducks in, they'll clean up the slugs, snails and the eggs.
And they don't damage any of the plants or flowers?
No, as long as you don't leave them in there too long.
Carol's methods are an accessible set of principles that can be used by anyone, from an aspiring farmer like John or a gardener with a more modest plot.
However much land you've got, whether it be, you know, half acre or whether you've got hundreds of acres, the important thing is to get to know your piece of land. You know,
to understand
where are the wet
it.
Bits, where are the cold bits? You want to know where your stony soil is, where your fertility is, so that you're working with nature and not against it.
That's fantastic, Carol. Thank you very much for your time today.
Yes,
I think we've learned an enormous amount, and I think it's fair to say you've got an enormous amount still to learn.
Having been inspired by Carol's farming masterclass, let's hope John and Karen can find their perfect rural patch here in the southwest. It's the second day of our property search in Devon with Karen and John from Maidenhead in Berkshire. For their budget of £1.25 million, they're looking for the perfect small holding to fulfil their big rural ambitions. Whilst there's no limit on acreage, compromises on property size have proved to be a challenge so far. Still to come, a change of direction at our mystery house.
We've gone up, across, we've come down.
Still trying to get my bearings.
It's really, really tricky. I told you, it will fox you for a considerable amount of time.
And I go back to nature in search of an extremely rare sighting.
Somewhere underneath that tree stump is a beaver maybe listening to us.
No. You're about 10 metres from England's only wild beavers.
Well, if yesterday was a day of discovery trying to find out exactly what John and Karen are after, today really does have to deliver because, let's face it, we're not there yet. We are trying to strike this interesting balance between having a lot of land and having a lot of house. I think we're getting there, and that's where I think our two properties today will really come into their own. It will end, of course, with our mystery house, though you may be thinking, that gorgeous treehouse is it. They could certainly afford it with their very generous budget, but no, for our final offering, we have got something altogether much bigger. But first, a property which, frankly, I think is the prettiest of the week.
For this gem of a house, we're border hopping into Somerset to the village of Roadwater on the northern edge of the Exmoor National Park. Set on the banks of the River Washford, its narrow lanes and passageways are lined with a picture-perfect collection of cottages. The array of amenities are enjoyed by local residents and include a pub, a community-run shop, along with an ingenious way of sharing stories. And just on the edge of the village, our next property really delivers on rural curb appeal.
Looking promising.
This, I think, is beautiful. And I think its size probably speaks for itself.
It does.
This comes with 14 acres.
Right.
Still enough, that wing over there contains two purpose-designed holiday lets.
Creating an income.
And a pretty good income at that.
Right.
Conservatively, they're doing about £25,000 a year. And you've still got plenty of space to, you know, have a bit of fun doing some hobby farming, etc. But the really exciting thing is that building. Come on.
This stunning stone-built farmhouse dates back to around 1540 and is both beautiful and substantial. The two holiday lets are set in a dedicated self-contained wing with their own private garden. At the heart of Karen and John's potential home are two large reception areas, great for entertaining. At the far end, there's a practical set of storerooms and a utility. One corner of the property provides a cosy sitting room next to the kitchen, which Karen will be eager to see. So that's where we're going.
Squeaky door. Come in, Karen.
Not as big as I'd hoped for, but we're definitely getting there.
Yes! Excellent, excellent.
It might not be vast, still room for the table, lovely window seat there. Yeah.
Well, look, they've got a tiny dining table in here for the simple reason that they have an enormous dining room through this door. Come and have a look. Do you see what I mean? I love it.
Oh, wow.
That's good.
Well, that's Christmas lunch sorted out, isn't it?
And the ceiling height's good as well.
Yeah. Come and have a look at the living room. More space to have fun in. It's not the biggest living room in the world.
Yeah, this is just that little bit bigger than the snug at the other end, and that snug very much day-to-day, whereas here, probably more somewhere to retire with guests and have a little bit of extra space and show off a little bit more, I guess.
So that's pretty much it for the ground floor, but I can't wait to see what you will make of those holiday lets. Come in with me.
This property retains many of its 16th century origins. Those features continue upstairs, where there are five wonderful bedrooms. The luxurious master comes with a dressing room, and the remaining four feature yet more exposed beams and make use of a stylish family bathroom, complete with roll-top bath. We, however, are off to see what gives this home its income-earning clout.
The property as a whole is original, but the current owners converted this end into holiday cottages less than 10 years ago. A decision, I'm sure, that's paid dividends.
Now, this is the bigger of the two. You've got this enormous kind of kitchen area with a dining end, as you can see.
Beautifully done.
Really high end.
Yes, it is.
So let's go outside and start thinking about the price, because, you know, there's a lot happening to this
here.
One, isn't there?
Yeah.
Yes, there's certainly plenty for our couple to get their heads around at this one. And outside is no exception, with extensive equestrian facilities, including a stable building providing a total of 9 loose boxes. This gives them the potential to have a horse-focused business running alongside the existing holiday lets.
Now, as you can see, your 14 acres are in a much more elevated position. So it's a mixture of useful flat paddocks and then something a bit more hilly. Is this working for you?
I think it is working for me.
Yeah?
Yes.
Is it working for John? Is this enough, 14 acres?
I haven't quite got it in my head what I'm going to do with it. I'm not really a horsey person, but you never know.
So, what do you think this is on the market for?
I think it's right at the top end of our budget. Mm-hmm. So, I'm going to go £1.25
million. £1.25 million. OK, John?
I'm going to push all the chips in.
Yeah.
We're going all in, and if I can agree at £1.25 million.
It's the right guess. £1.25 million is the asking price of this one.
Spot on.
So it's affordable.
Yeah, it's no surprise in that.
No.
Go and have a look around. Enjoy that sumptuous property, and I will find you later on. Go on. Off you go.
Thank you.
That's my pleasure. That's what we're here for. You wanted a country house, you came to the right place. So while they go and have a look around at that gorgeous property, I am going to go and have a look at this even prettier young foal.
Bang on budget, this 16th century farmhouse comes with 5 bedrooms and 2 up-and-running holiday lets. And there's ample entertaining space to host friends and family. Plus, it comes with 14 acres and stables, offering plenty of scope for John to keep livestock.
Coming down the drive to begin with, immediately I thought, well, here goes the budget. It's spectacular.
I think I've become so focused on a kitchen. I'd never even thought about a dining room, but that dining room is magnificent. I want this quite a lot, actually. It's beautiful.
Right, before we go, I want to just show you my new little friend. Dolly, come on. Isn't that just the most gorgeous thing?
Oh.
Boy, have we set the scene for you here.
You have indeed.
Well, look, I'm not going to ask you if this is the one you are going to buy, because, of course, we have one more property to see, and that is our mystery house. But I suspect Dolly and her mum will sit long in our memories. Come on, let's go. Lead them to the sunshine.
To conclude our house hunt, we're travelling back into Devon and heading south to the beautiful village of Branscombe, right down on the southeast Jurassic coastline. Perhaps its chief claim to fame is being known as the longest village in England. Its main street sweeps down past stunning period properties before arriving at the beach. Living this close to the coast would be highly desirable for most, but more often than not, it means homes with limited plot sizes. With John's desire for lots of land, it could be that this enticing mystery coastal offering will challenge them to rethink that farming lifestyle.
So, at last, our mystery house. Have a look at that.
Very pretty. Very unusual.
The reason we have selected this as our mystery house, this one doesn't come with a great deal of land. So it's all about the building. I don't know about you, but I feel I'm standing in the south of France with this lovely white wall, the blue windows, the wisteria. It's crazy, and yet we're in Devon.
Definitely got that Mediterranean feel about
it. Shall we have a look?
Definitely.
Let's get inside.
This former corn mill is believed to date back to the 18th century and remained in operation until 1914. Built from stone, its impressive facade seems to have left John lost for words. Or maybe it's the mystery revelation about the lack of land.
OK, Karen, come on in, John.
It's not a bad space.
It's a beautiful kitchen. Yeah. It's probably just not got enough of anything in particular to really swing it. It doesn't quite have the size.
Do you know what I think is going on? I think we have so wooed you with our last property that it's in your mind. Come with me. Let's continue.
Leaving the kitchen behind us, the quirky layout starts to unfold. Spread over three floors, our mystery house is chock full of originality. Climbing up one set of the two staircases, we pass rooms tucked away on half levels.
So, a house of many levels. There's the dining room.
On the first floor lies the property's master bedroom and its adjoining bathroom. Across the other side is the sitting room, which we'll explore.
The main living room, complete with inglenook and burner.
It's beautifully decorated. It's very pretty.
But it's not the last house.
No.
This often happens.
Which is sad. It doesn't do this justice.
No, it doesn't. Because it's a beautiful house. In a way, it's a risk we run in showing you something which you absolutely fall in love with, and then we take you to another property, which is always going to struggle. Come on, let me show you up here.
On the top floor of our mystery property are the five additional bedrooms. Each one retains its authentic feel with exposed timbers and simple white walls, all fitting into the footprint of the old mill. It's certainly a warren of rooms to make sense of. We're crossing this floor and going down the second set of stairs, back to the first floor, where we find the master.
And then finally, bedroom six is the master.
So we've come down a level.
We've gone up, we've gone across, we've come down.
Still trying to get my bearings.
It's really, really tricky. I told you it will fox you for a considerable amount of time. But never mind all that. You could be waking up here looking out to this very, very pretty valley. Yeah.
It's beautifully quiet, very peaceful down here.
I think we should get outside, get some fresh air and consider this one in its totality, because the reason we are here is so that we are not spending lots of money.
Moving outside, there's a garage, a greenhouse for Karen, and a seating area with a summer house. The mystery property comes with just under an acre of land, including an area of woodland brimming with wildlife. There's also a running stream, and although John won't be able to have large livestock, there's plenty of space for chickens.
Look, a hint of sunshine. Hurrah. A nice way to finish our house tours in the garden of our mystery house, mystery mill.
Very pretty little garden out here, beautifully kept.
Very different to where we started, with 80 acres on top of a hill. So I'm very happy with the range we've given you, but there is one more thing to do, and that is to get you to estimate the price of our mystery house.
So we've taken away the land, we've just got the house, but we've introduced the proximity to the coastline, £775,000.
Okay, Kat?
800,000.
800,000. You are both really good at this. This is on the market for £795,000. I'm going to give you one more chance to see if you can get around that property without getting lost. Take it all in, see what you get for nearly £800,000. And I will find you very, very shortly. Go on, off you go.
I've got a ball of cotton in my pocket.
You might need that.
More than £450,000 under budget, this 18th century mystery mill serves up a unique property, but a downsize on land. It comes with a fair-sized kitchen, six bedrooms, and outside there's almost an acre of land in a gorgeous valley setting, a stone's throw from Devon's Jurassic coast.
It's a very pretty, quirky little house.
It's difficult to appreciate this property because we're making comparisons to what we've seen already.
I think it's fair comment, but in isolation, I think we would still struggle to come to terms with this property, its layout and its positioning. It doesn't match what we're trying to achieve.
I think we'll all agree, a beautiful house, but of course you can buy only one of them. So I think now we need to get you somewhere where you can sit down and think about it all, and then I'll come and grill you. Come on.
So starting in the Blackdown Hills in Somerset and wending its way through Devon all the way to the Jurassic coast, the River Otter extends for some 20 miles. This natural waterway is home to a diverse range of wildlife, including, as its name suggests, otters. Recently, though, the river has a new resident. Hunted to extinction over 400 years ago, beavers have made a remarkable reappearance along these banks. Amateur footage revealed a group of beavers were living and breeding here. The Devon Wildlife Trust have been granted a license by the government to monitor the beavers' activity and the impact they're having on their new habitat. To find out more about the consequences of their arrival, I'm meeting Steve Hussey from the Trust to hear how the story is unfolding.
Steve, I am fascinated by this story of what appear to be a rather characterful and quite maverick band of beavers who've decided to set up shop here in Devon, of all places, on the River Otter. I mean, what's going on?
Well, you should be fascinated by it. These are the only beavers that we know of breeding wild in England, and they're the only beavers to do so probably for 400, 500, even 600 years.
I mean, it's astonishing. Where did they come from?
Honest answer, we don't know. They might be escapes. Someone might have let them out. You can't just let animals out willy-nilly into the landscape. So DEFRA wanted to remove these beavers. We stepped in and said, hang on a minute, let's do a trial, see what impact they have on a river in England.
How many have you been able to identify?
We think there are around 20 beavers living on this stretch of river, and the river itself is only about 20, 25 miles long. So there's plenty of room for more beavers. We're far from being at beaver max.
So what are the chances of us actually spotting a beaver today?
I would say something between nil and about 5%. I can't pretend to you we're going to see beavers.
But we might see some traces of their activity.
We'll definitely see traces. Some are more subtle than others, and one of the things I'm going to ask you is to spot those signs.
Come on then, let's have a hunt.
The best time to see beavers is at dusk and dawn. Entirely herbivorous, their diet consists of riverside plants like yellow flag iris and Himalayan balsam. But I'm on the hunt for something bigger that they enjoy biting into.
Ah, there.
They've got these huge incisors, top and bottom, that act as big chisels, and they're even fortified with iron.
They've chopped right through
have,
the outside of the tree, haven't they?
They have.
Little bit by little bit, gnawing every single bit.
So what they've done is created a patch that sunlight can get down to at the edge of the river. They're what we call a keystone species, so they just don't sit in the landscape without being noticed. They actually shape the landscape to purpose themselves.
Beavers are Europe's largest native rodent and can swim underwater for up to 15 minutes at a time. It's a skill that comes in very handy when they're entering their lodge.
So what are we looking at here?
This is where the beavers live, and their lodge is just over there. But the entrance to the lodge is actually under the water surface, and that acts as a security barrier to them. So they're safe and secure as we speak in there.
It's amazing. Somewhere underneath that tree stump is a beaver maybe listening to us.
No. You're about 10 metres from England's only wild beavers. But you're going to have to take my word
for
that.
Well, I am.
But I have got some film footage that I took just here last summer that I can show you of the female.
You got it on your phone?
Yeah, I can.
Oh, brilliant.
So, she has just cut some willow just up on the bank there.
Up there, yeah.
Yeah, and she's brought it back into the river, and she's taking that back to her kits who are underground. She'll do that, you know, a dozen more times of an evening.
Are you optimistic that these beavers have a long-term future here on the Otter?
The most amazing thing is to think that we're the first human beings for centuries to be able to see beavers in England.
Fabulous. Well, let's leave them to their slumbers, Steve. Come on.
Steve and his team are in the midst of a time-sensitive five-year project, and there's still more research to be done. They have until 2020, when a decision will be made on the beaver's future. It'll be interesting to see how this wildlife story continues in the years to come. We've shown John and Karen a rich mix of thought-provoking properties, so it's time to reflect and take stock. And what better way to do so than beside the sea?
Yeah, I see. Here am I, wandering around, looking for you two, and you're enjoying a snooze.
It's been a tough day.
It has been a tough day. It's been a busy week, isn't it? Now, you gave us the challenge. You requested that we find you lots and lots of acres and a house to go with it. Mm. And we showed you, to start with, 80 acres and a house thrown in, didn't we, Karen?
You did indeed.
I learnt
that actually the house was more important to both of you than you had perhaps thought.
Yes, the land there was magnificent. It wasn't what I would have prescribed for us, but with a sensible head on about how important a house has to be to you, it did crystallise us a little bit about how much focus we need to lend to that as well.
Yeah.
It can't all be about the land.
I think we then set out on a journey that would try and bring some balance to that equation. I think that astonishing property, the Thatch, in Somerset, is probably your favourite, Karen. Am I right?
You are right. That's definitely my favourite property.
Although it didn't have 80 acres, it did have 14, and alongside it, a fabulous suite of holiday lets.
Clearly, the value that was there was so evident.
Yeah.
The holiday lets were wonderful. The land, OK, it may not have been where my mind was at the start of the journey, but clearly it was usable land.
Have we managed to do it? Have we found you a property that will work?
If I'm brutal, I think I'm going to have to say no.
No, I think for you, Karen, it pretty much sold itself. Are you happy to say goodbye to it at this stage and keep looking?
I really love the property, but there was always that niggle at the back of my mind. Would it be enough land for John? Would it tick every box? So as much as I love the house, would it be my heart over my head?
You're breaking my heart. I can see that this search is going to continue. I hope that you go into the next phase of your house hunt with renewed focus on the importance of a house that is going to work for both of you. And I think if nothing else, we've managed to do that. And I do hope that you manage to find something with enough land around it to keep you busy, John. And for goodness sake, let us know what you buy and what you end up doing.
We look forward to finding out ourselves where we end up.
Well, so do I. I'm exhausted. Come on, soak up the sun, why not? Oh, lovely. Well, a very healthy budget this week has meant, of course, that we've been able to see some extremely handsome houses. Now, often as not, when we describe our properties during our house tours, we chuck out lots of vital statistics, but to be honest, they can just disappear into thin air. So I thought, well, at the end of this week, we might draw them together because the figures are truly staggering. If you had bought all three of our properties, you'd have had to spend just over £3 million. And not only would you have ended up with three distinct houses, you would have had a combined acreage of just under 100 acres to play with. Now, of course, John and Karen's search will continue. And if their lesson tells us anything, it is perhaps this. Regardless of your budget, big or otherwise, it doesn't always mean that you can buy what you're looking for when you think you want it. The search will go on. I'll see you next time.
If you would like to escape to the country in Northern Ireland, Scotland, Wales or England and need our help, why not apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.